Thank you, Vicki. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
So glad you're here tonight. We're going to have a good look again at Luke chapter 1. If you'd open your Bibles to Luke 1, we're going to continue tonight in what we started last week, a close look at events that immediately precede the birth of Christ. Before Messiah could be born, the forerunner of the Lord had to appear, the one who would, quote, clear the way for the Lord in the wilderness, make smooth in the desert a highway for our God, as Isaiah said. The mission of the forerunner was to prepare the hearts of Jewish people for Messiah, and the story of his coming is found in Luke chapter 1, along with a great deal more of really important revelation. Last week, we saw God entering human history for the first time in a long time when the angel Gabriel suddenly appeared to a priest named Zacharias. You may recall from last week, we met Zacharias and Elizabeth, righteous people living as best they could under the law of God. Zacharias was no doubt a humble man, one of 18,000 priests serving in Israel at that time, and he was chosen by lot to enter into the temple and to burn incense. And while he was engaged in that ministry, suddenly the angel Gabriel appeared to him. You can bet that John was frightened, but the angel had a very important message to Zacharias, and I'm sure his wife Elizabeth would learn about it sooner or later. Even though they were way beyond childbearing years, the angel said to Zacharias, "Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you will give him the name John." This son of Zacharias is none other than John the Baptist, whose ministry was prophesied in the Old Testament by Isaiah and Malachi and fulfilled in the months before Jesus began his earthly ministry. Listen to the very last verses of the Old Testament. Malachi 4, 5, and 6 are the last two verses of the Old Testament. "Behold, I am going to send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and terrible day of the Lord. He will restore the hearts of the fathers to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers, so that I will not come and smite the land with a curse." Now, I've just given you something where you can answer a Bible trivia question and win all the gold there is to win. What is the last word in the Old Testament? Curse. Very interesting. This is the one that Gabriel is talking about. John the Baptist prophesied not only in Malachi 3 and in Isaiah 40, but in Malachi 4, the last two verses of the Old Testament. This is the one about whom Jesus said, "No one born of woman is greater than John the Baptist." And that's where we're going to start tonight, with the greatness of John. Our portion is Luke 1, 15 through 23. Now, I'm sure you're aware, if you're looking at your Bibles, that verse 15 is right in the middle of Gabriel's opening statement to Zacharias. So we're going to pick it up in verse 13 for context and read that entire passage. Luke 1, 13 through 23. "But the angel said to him, 'Do not be afraid, Zacharias, for your petition has been heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you will give him the name John. You will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth.'" This is where we'll start tonight. "For he will be great in the sight of the Lord, and he will drink no wine or liquor, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit while yet in his mother's womb. And he will turn many of the sons of Israel back to the Lord their God. It is he who will go before as a forerunner before him in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers back to their children and the disobedient to the attitude of the righteous, so as to make ready a people prepared for the Lord.' Zacharias said to the angel, 'How will I know this for certain? For I'm an old man, and my wife is advanced in years.' The angel answered and said to him, 'I am Gabriel, who stands in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you and bring you this good news. And behold, you shall be silent and unable to speak until the day when these things take place, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled in their proper time.' Well, the people were waiting for Zacharias and wondering at his delay in the temple. But when he came out, he was unable to speak to them, and they realized that he had seen a vision in the temple, and he kept making signs to them and remained mute. When the days of his priestly service were ended, he went back
home.
Well, I know you'll be shocked to learn that we have a three-point outline tonight. The first point is the greatness of John the Baptist in verses 15 through 17. Then Zacharias' unbelief in verses 18 through 20. And then finally, Zacharias' ministry ends in verses 21 through 23. Let's talk about the greatness of John the Baptist. He will be great in the sight of the Lord. Jesus said of John, among those born of women, no one greater. Abraham wasn't greater. Moses wasn't greater. Daniel wasn't greater. None were greater than John the Baptist. Well, what made him so great? First of all, his dedication to the Lord. And this is revealed in the phrase, he will drink no wine or liquor. We believe that John was the only New Testament Nazarite. In Numbers chapter 6, God gave Moses instruction about those taking a Nazarite vow. Speak to the sons of Israel and say to them, when a man or a woman, did you know that women could be Nazarites and were Nazarites? When a man or a woman makes a special vow, the vow of a Nazarite, to dedicate himself to the Lord. This is what John the Baptist did. He shall abstain from wine and strong drink. Well, John was dedicated to God, given over to the Lord, consumed with and focused on the things of the Lord over and above everything else. Friends, this kind of narrow focus is common among people who do great things for God. In Acts 18:5, it says, Paul devoted himself completely to the word, solemnly testifying to the Jews that Jesus was the Christ. In Luke 5:11, James and John left everything and followed Jesus. In Luke 5:28, Jesus said to Levi, follow me. And Levi left everything behind and rose and began to follow him. Now, Levi was a tax collector, a chief tax collector, which means he was rich. Tax collectors got rich by collecting more than the Romans wanted them to, keeping some for themselves and giving the rest to the Romans. By the way, we learned this as we studied through Luke. Levi had a second name. Do you know what that second name was or is? Matthew. And do you know that this former tax collector, this sinner, was the Matthew that wrote the great gospel of Matthew? Don't think that you've made a mistake and God can never use you. His salvation is perfect in restoring people and using them for himself. Luke 18:28, Peter said, we have left our own homes and followed you. Now, if you're listening, you know, with your ears on, some of us feel uncomfortable about statements like that. It can be discouraging to believers because in response to those verses, a lot of people say, I have other things that I have to do in my life, right? For instance, some of you are still working. Oren came into my office earlier in the evening and we got engaged in a conversation. I said, what did you do today? He said, I worked today. I still work. Well, you know, we have to work. Paul was a tent maker for part of his ministry. We have to support ourselves. All of us have things to do like clean the house and mow the lawn and get the car serviced and, you know, go to the store and all that kind of stuff. Practical everyday activities of daily life. How can we have the level of dedication that John the Baptist, Paul, Peter, the Apostle John, and Levi had? Here's something very helpful, friends. Those guys, first of all, had activities of daily life too. They had to eat. They had to rest. Jesus said to his disciples in Mark 6, come away by yourselves to a secluded place and rest a while, you see. My first pastor, David Evans, said the most spiritual thing a tired person can do is sleep. There were many people coming and going, and they didn't even have time to eat. Part of the Christian life is maintaining a balance between burning out, you know, just so dedicated to the Lord that you're doing something every day, every moment of every day, and on the other hand, rusting out from never doing anything. We have this balance. We've got to find that middle ground where we can serve our whole lives. As I said, for a time, Paul supported himself as a tent maker. Here's how all this fits together. We want to be dedicated to the Lord. We want to have our entire lives dedicated to Him. Well, here's how we do it. We live in such a way that all the normal, mundane, routine, yet necessary activities of daily life are accomplished so that they support our dedication to God. For instance, I work so I can support my family as God wants me to. Paul said in 1 Timothy 5:8, if anyone does not provide for his own, and especially for those of his household, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. God knows that most people have to work. And I know a lot of you are retired, but you worked for decades during your working life. There's four reasons that I can think of that we should earn money. First of all, to support our families. And if you'll look at that verse closely, it's not only our immediate families, but also our extended families. Secondly, to support the church. Third, to support missionaries. And fourth, to give money to the poor. That's in no particular order. All four of those things need to be done. For those of you who are still working, Oren, this can really help. I'm going to work today because God wants me to. This is my expression of my dedication to God. This is my ministry to my family. And so when we go to work, you see, we work as if God was our employer. Paul said that in Colossians 3, do your work heartily, as for the Lord rather than for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the reward of the inheritance. It is the Lord Christ whom you serve. So if you happen to be working, you know, praise the Lord. You're serving the Lord if you serve with that thought in mind. This will help, friends. It gives our work heavenly significance. Other activities of daily living can have the same motivation. I mow the lawn and paint the house so I'll be a good neighbor and have a good testimony in the neighborhood. I fix dinner, or in my case, I go to McDonald's. So I'll have the strength to serve the Lord. Listen, this even fits into stuff like exercise. I go to the gym not only because I enjoy it, but I've asked the Lord for 27 more years. Okay, I'm 73. I want to live to 100. It's just recently in my life, I've come again. See the support I have. Just recently, I've kind of settled on, you know, what I want to do for the rest of my life. And I kind of got a late start on it. And so, you know, 27 years is a good long time that I could accomplish something. In order to do that, I have to maintain my weight. I have to keep my weight down, and I have to get exercise so the old ticker will still work. When I'm 98 years old, I want to be able to get out of a chair so I can tell people what I want them to hear, you see. So even going to the gym and getting exercise fits into and supports our dedication to God. Everything in our lives is to be done in order to support the ministry of Jesus Christ. And that ministry of Jesus Christ is what the church is doing, what missionaries are doing, and what you are doing in the specific ministry that God has called you to. Can I get an amen? John the Baptist had activities of daily living. Did you know that? He had to gather locusts and wild honey. But they were not the focus of his life. And it can be, and it should be, the same for us. Everything we do fits into our service to God. So John was great because of his dedication to the Lord. Second, and still in verse 15, he was great because of his oneness in spirit with God. And he will be filled with the Holy Spirit while yet in his mother's womb. Friends, in all the Bible, this is said only of John the Baptist. He's the only one who was filled with the Holy Spirit while in his mother's womb. A remarkable manifestation of this filling is in Luke 1:41. We'll get there in 3 weeks. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb. John the Baptist leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. So John was great because of his dedication to God and because he yielded himself to the control of God, full of God's Holy Spirit. God really ran his life. Now, just like working people can be concerned that they really can't be dedicated to the Lord, but they can be. This filling of the Holy Spirit is confusing to a lot of Christian people. And I wanted to share a few verses that I hope will help because, you know, I struggle in this area too. I want to be filled with the Spirit all the time, but sometimes I don't know whether I am or not. So maybe this will help. You're familiar with Ephesians 5:18. Do not get drunk with wine, for that is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit. John fulfilled both halves of that verse, by the way. He did not drink, period, and he was filled with the Holy Spirit. But what I want us to get from this is that this filling of the Spirit happens more than once. This is not the baptism of the Holy Spirit that every Christian gets at the moment of salvation. This is a repeated filling. It's to be a continual thing. Keep being filled with God's Holy Spirit. If you're filled with him today, great. How about tomorrow, you see, and the next day? Be sure to be filled with him every day. It's a continual filling. A second thing we learn from Ephesians 5:18 is the idea of control. Do not be drunk with wine. In other words, do not come under the control of alcohol, but be filled with the Spirit. Be under His control. So being filled with the Spirit is to be a daily thing resulting in His control of us. We see this in Galatians 5:16. But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not carry out the desires of the flesh. If we're walking with the Spirit, He will guide our steps. He will keep us from sin. He will lead us into godly living. We'll be under His control. And here is some really good news. You know, we can always tell whether or not we are filled with the Spirit. Did you know that? Every minute of every day, we can know whether or not we're under His control by the qualities that are evident in our lives. What are they called? What are these qualities called? The fruit of the Spirit. It is an ever-present scoreboard, friends, telling us how we're doing, reminding us whether or not we are under the control of God's Holy Spirit. You know what they are, but they bear repeating. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, 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 kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. You know what that means? It is always right to be loving. It is always right to be peaceful. It is always right to be kind and good. It's never a sin to be those things. If we are filled with the Spirit, those things will be evident in our life. And here's the way I try to work this out, and I'm not setting myself up with some paragon of being filled with the Spirit. I wrestle with this just like you do. But the simplest way that I can understand it myself is this. When we are immersed in the things of Christ, when Jesus is on our minds and lips throughout the day, again, that first pastor, David Evans, gave me three principles to live my life by: proper use of time, proper motive, and practicing the presence of Christ. When Jesus is on our minds and lips throughout the day, when we are actively looking for ways to serve Him and other people, when our highest desire is to be pleasing to Him, when we are battling sin and pursuing holiness, when we are in the Word and in prayer, when we are living the life, friends, when we are connected to the vine, John 15, when we are renewing our minds with the Word of God, Romans chapter 12, we will be filled with God's Holy Spirit. There are no shortcuts to that. We have to be immersed in the things of Christ. And again, we have that blessed scoreboard, the evidence of the fruit of the Spirit within. Why was John great? He was dedicated to the Lord. His life was turned over to the Lord, and he was filled with God's Spirit. He was under the Spirit's control. And here's what his life accomplished in verse 16, and he will turn many of the sons of Israel back to the Lord their God. John had a ministry of reconciliation, repairing the relationship between the sons of Israel and the Lord their God. Speaking of John, Malachi 4:6 tells us of another ministry he had. He will restore the hearts of the fathers to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers. So John's ministry not only repaired human relationships with God, but he also repaired family relationships. John did this by preaching repentance. It's an Old Testament message. The message of the prophets was always repent. And John's message was repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. By the way, those were also the first words out of Jesus' mouth in his earthly ministry. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. In order for reconciliation to take place between an unholy people and a holy God, repentance must happen. And John was fearless in proclaiming it. He was effective too. I love to read John's ministry in Luke 3. Here's a sample. Luke 3, this is just a snippet out of 7 through 14. So he began saying to the crowds who were going out to be baptized by him, "You brood of vipers," there's a good way to draw a crowd, "you brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come?" 1 Thessalonians 1:10 says that Jesus delivered us from the wrath to come, but he said, "Who warned you to flee? Therefore bear fruit in keeping with repentance." Some people say that repentance is simply changing your mind, and it is that. But a change of mind also results in a change of life and lifestyle. Repentance is more than changing your mind about Jesus. It is also changing your life, which we see in the verses after that where John is still ministering. The crowds were questioning him, saying, "What then shall I do?" And he would answer and say to them, "The man who has two tunics is to share with him who has none, and he who has food is to do likewise. We are to be generous with the poor. Some tax collectors also came to be baptized, and they said to him, Teacher, what shall we do? And he said to them, Collect more than what you have been ordered to. Stop skimming off the top for yourself. Some soldiers were questioning him, saying, And what about us? What shall we do? And he said to them, Do not take money from anyone by force, which they routinely did, or accuse anyone falsely, which they routinely did for money, and be content with your wages. To repent and to be reconciled with God is to change your mind about three things. First of all, you change your mind about your sin. You agree with God about your sin. You agree with Romans 3:23 that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. You change your mind about your need of a Savior, like the tax collector of Luke 18:13, who said, Be merciful to me, God, the sinner. And you change your mind about how you're going to live the rest of your life. I love 1 Peter 4:1-2. Arm yourselves also with this purpose. Get ready for battle with this purpose, so as to live the rest of the time in the flesh, as long as we live in these bodies, no longer for the lust of men, but for the will of God. Well, the greatness of John continues in verse 17. It is he who will go before as a forerunner before him in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers back to the children and the disobedient to the attitude of the righteous, so as to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. In the spirit and power of Elijah. Remember Malachi 4:5? I'm going to send you Elijah the prophet. In Matthew 11:14, Jesus said of John the Baptist, And if you are willing to accept it, John himself is Elijah who was to come. In Elijah, his ministry is most clearly stated in 1 Kings 18. Elijah came near to all the people and said, How long will you hesitate between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal is, follow him, you know, make your choice, life or death. John's ministry accomplished the same thing. His ministry was to turn the disobedient to the attitude of the righteous so as to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. And here is an important question for us to ask and answer. Did John succeed in that mission? Were the people of Israel prepared for their Messiah? There are many who say, John failed in his ministry. For after all, the nation of Israel rejected her Messiah. John 1:11 says he came to his own, and those who were his own did not receive him. Israel's leaders relentlessly plotted to kill Jesus, and the common people in the end screamed for his crucifixion. As you know, John himself was beheaded by Herod. John's ministry began well enough, Matthew 3. Then Jerusalem was going out to him and all Judea and all the district around the Jordan, and they were being baptized by him in the Jordan River as they confessed their sins. But when Herod arrested him, not a single person objected. Not a single person defended him. No one came to bring him any aid. And of course, Jesus, the one John would go before and prepare a people for, Jesus died a cruel criminal's death. Where is John's victory? Where is John's success? Of course, we could ask the same of Jesus. At the very end, even most of his disciples abandoned him. Peter denied him. At the cross, the apostle John was the only man there, besides the guards, of course, and a few women. Well, to answer the question, where is John's victory and where is John's success, it's very important to us because sometimes we don't see results from our ministry either, do we? Sometimes we work and pray and work and pray, and we're seeking a particular result, yet we do not see the fruit that we long for. For years, we pray for loved ones, and they remain stuck in spiritual blindness. Someone recently told me of her repeated attempts to invite a neighbor to church, just to invite a neighbor to church, and this neighbor refuses to come. Are we failures like John the Baptist? Well, John was no failure, and here's why. I wish you'd write this down, maybe in the back corner of your mind. He did what God called him to do. Okay? God had called him to proclaim a baptism of repentance, and he did that. John preached to multiplied thousands of people, and untold millions have read his words, none more important than, Behold, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. Not only did John do what God called him to, but God used what John had done to bring about the phenomenal growth of the early church. When someone points out that John was beheaded and Jesus was crucified, implying they were failures, we should remember that in Acts 2:41, on the birthday of the church, 3,000 people got saved. Why did all those people respond to Peter's message? Because they had heard the message of John the Baptist. Many of them had been baptized by John, and they were prepared. They had heard about and seen the miracles of Jesus. Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead about a week before he himself was crucified, and hundreds, if not thousands, of Jews saw that because it was at the time of Passover, and Bethany was very close to Jerusalem. So they had laid the foundation, John and Jesus did, and a great many people, 3,000, on the birthday of the church, got saved. Acts 4:4 says, "But many of those who had heard the message believed, and the number of the men came to be about 5,000. Acts 6:7, the word of God kept on spreading, and the number of the disciples continued to increase greatly in Jerusalem, and a great many of the priests were becoming obedient to the faith." Some of these guys, no doubt, had heard Jesus debating with the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and maybe they even saw him before the chief priests, and it rang up in their minds, but it didn't sink home until after the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Acts 12:24, the word of the Lord continued to grow and be multiplied. Acts 19:20, so the word of God was growing mightily and prevailing. You bet John was successful. You bet Jesus was successful. Jesus and John laid a foundation, Jesus being the cornerstone, that every other believer, every other preacher, and I don't mean just pastors, but people who announce the gospel, have been building on ever since. Thousands of Jews had their eyes and hearts opened by John's ministry and Jesus' ministry, and all of that came to fruition when the Church of Jesus Christ was born. The point being, friends, you may not see all of the fruit in your ministry that you want to see in your lifetime, but if we are dedicated to the Lord the way John was, and if we are doing what God has asked us to do, and if we're being controlled by the Spirit of God, there will be fruit. Even if it's deferred. Paul is another example of this. Paul was beheaded, we believe, in the 60s of the first century, AD 64 or so. During his lifetime, many of the churches he planted were small and struggling. There was a large church in Jerusalem where all those people got saved on Pentecost and many thereafter. But some of those outlying churches like Philippi and Corinth and the Colossae were small churches. When we were studying through Colossians, I found one commentator who said that the letter of Colossians was written to a church of 40 people. I don't know if that's right or not, but I'll tell you what, those churches were not mega churches. Okay. There were dozens, perhaps hundreds of people at the most. But by the end of the first century, historians believe there were about 500,000 believers in the area where the gospel had spread to by that time. And apart from the Lord Jesus, many historians credit Paul with being the most responsible for the phenomenal growth of the early church. Paul never saw it, but his dedication and his faithfulness God used to produce it. Don't give up, friends. Leave the fruit business to God. You do what God has called you to do. You be faithful in your own ministry. You be faithful in your own prayer life and leave the results to God. Our role is to be faithful and to work and to pray and to sacrifice and to suffer and to submit and to serve. And God will cause the growth. He said, of course, Paul said that very thing in 1 Corinthians 3:6. I planted, Apollos watered, but what? God caused the growth. Rest in that, friends. Rest in that. Don't worry about how the results. Worry about the quality of your ministry. Well, the greatness of John the Baptist, he was dedicated, he was filled with God's Spirit, and he did what God called him to do. Now we come to Zacharias' unbelief, remarkable three verses, 18, 19, and 20. Zacharias said to the angel, "How will I know this for certain? For I am an old man, and my wife is advanced in years." I hope she wasn't listening. Well, probably not. You know, he was in the temple. Let's see, just who had been praying for a child? If you look back at verse 13, the angel said to him, "Your petition has been heard." Guess what his petition was? "Oh God, I want a child." Just who was it that was serving an all-powerful God? And who had access to the Holy Scriptures that told of our miracle-working God and the many times that old people had children in the Bible? One commentator said this: Zacharias had been praying all this time for a child, and God sends an angel to announce he's going to have one, and he doesn't believe it. Reminds me of the people praying for Peter in Acts chapter 12. They had a prayer meeting because Peter was in prison. Oh God, get Peter out of prison. Well, the Lord lets him out, and he comes to the house to tell them he is out. He knocks on the door, and Rhoda goes to the door, and it's Peter. She doesn't even welcome him in. She just turns around and runs inside and says, Peter's outside. And they said, what? Can't be. It must be his angel because Peter's in prison. You see, not exactly great faith. Here's one to take home with you. Faith is important, friends, but it is not all important. What is important is the will and the working and the power of God. Psalm 115, verse 3 says, our God is in the heavens. He does whatever he pleases. The action of God, the will of God, the power of God, God himself is all important. Zacharias had a right to be surprised by the angel's appearance, but he should not have been surprised by his message. Verse 19, the angel answered and said to him, I am Gabriel, you knucklehead, who stands in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you and to bring you this good news. You know, take that. This is the harshest of possible rebukes. I am Gabriel. This is the same angel who appeared to Daniel some 500 years before. Daniel 9. When you get home tonight, maybe tomorrow morning, you know, when you're rested, I implore you to read Daniel 9 beginning at verse 1. It is one of the very greatest prayers of confession you'll ever read in the Bible. We're just going to read verses 20 through 23. Now, while I, Daniel, was speaking and praying and confessing my sin and the sin of my people Israel and presenting my supplication before the Lord my God, while I was still speaking in prayer, then the man Gabriel came to me in my extreme weariness about the time of the evening offering. He gave me instruction and talked with me and said, O Daniel, I have now come forth to give you insight with understanding. At the beginning of your supplications, the command was issued. Isn't that interesting? As soon as Daniel started to pray, God told Gabriel, go and speak to this man. Listen, God hears our prayers. Do not give up in prayer. God hears. And I have come to tell you, for you are highly esteemed, so give heed to the message and gain understanding of the vision. Well, Gabriel continues to lambast Zacharias. I am Gabriel who stands in the presence of God. There are three angels named in the Bible. Two of them good, one of them terrible. The two good angels are Michael, a warrior angel, and Gabriel, God's super messenger angel, and the other one is Lucifer, better known as Satan, better known as destruction and destroyer. Well, this Gabriel, the super angel messenger, brought messages to Daniel, to Zacharias, to Mary, and perhaps to Joseph. In Matthew 2, when the angel appeared to Joseph in a dream and told him to not be afraid to wed Mary, that angel is not named, but if I was going to bet, I would bet it was Gabriel. And I have been sent to speak to you and to bring you this good news, sent from the presence of God with good news in answer to Zacharias' prayer. Yet Zacharias did not believe the message. Verse 20, and behold, you shall be silent and unable to speak until the day when these things take place, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled in their proper time. As if to say, if you don't believe God's word when you hear it, you won't be able to speak God's word either. Zechariah should not have been unbelieving. As we shall see, Mary also seemed to doubt God's message, didn't she? Why did Mary get a pass? And Zacharias was struck dumb. In response to Gabriel saying that she would bear a son, Mary said, how can this be, since I'm a virgin? So why did only Zacharias get hammered? Well, there's a couple of reasons. First of all, Zacharias had access to the Scriptures. They did not have Bibles like we have Bibles. Today, Bibles are as common as rocks. I don't know about you, but I must have 10 or 12 of them. I only can read one at a time. Why do I have 10 or 12? But I do. We collect them, you know. And therefore, Zechariah should have known all about Sarah. Who didn't know about Sarah? Everybody, I mean, Abraham, the beginning of the Jewish people. Everybody. How old was Abraham? About how old was he when Isaac was born? About 100. How old was Sarah? About 90. 190. We all know this. Zechariah should have known it. He should have known about Manoah's wife, Judges 13. He should have known about Hannah. Remember last week we mentioned Hannah in 1 Samuel 1. For this child I prayed, and the Lord heard my prayer. Listen, even Isaac's wife Rebekah had trouble becoming pregnant. Genesis 25:21 says, Isaac prayed to the Lord on behalf of his wife because she was barren, and the Lord answered him, and Rebekah, his wife, conceived, you see. Come on, Zacharias, didn't you know these things? Reminds me of Jesus, I think it's in Matthew 6, where he says, have you not read, talking to the scribes and Pharisees, have you not read, and you should have? Zacharias should have known these things, you see. He is without excuse. Perhaps Zacharias missed this in Saturday school. Did Jews have Saturday school? I don't know, but he missed it there. Mary most certainly did not have access to the scriptures. There were very few copies, and the priests and the Pharisees had them, and the common people did not. She may not have even been taught Bible truth. We don't know. So, Zechariah should have known because he had access to the scriptures. Secondly, Zacharias was 60-plus years old, having plenty of time to learn about and experience our omnipotent God. Mary was no doubt a teenager. After Sarah laughed at God's promise of a child, God said this, is anything too difficult for the Lord? At the appointed time, I will return to you, and Sarah will have a son. Zechariah should have used that in his prayers, but apparently did not. You see, there was precedent in the Bible for old people having children. But the virgin birth, friends, mark it down, is unique in all history. Never before and never again will a woman conceive a child without the participation of a man. It happened only once. It happened with Mary and the virgin birth of Jesus Christ our Lord. Can we get an amen? We've seen the greatness of John, his dedication, his control by God. We've seen Zacharias' unbelief, kind of sad. And finally, Zacharias' ministry ends in verses 21 through 23. The people were waiting for Zacharias and were wondering at his delay. Why were the people wondering? Well, perhaps they had read Leviticus 10, where Nadab and Abihu offered strange fire before the Lord, and they themselves were consumed with fire. And they thought, gee, maybe Zacharias is dead inside the temple. Verse 22, but when he came out, he was unable to speak to them, and they realized that he had seen a vision in the temple, and he kept making signs to them and remained mute. Zacharias wanted to speak. He kept making signs. He wanted to say, I saw and spoke with the angel Gabriel. He wanted to tell Elizabeth, we're going to have a son. You know, in the omnipotence of God, I kind of think that maybe God was protecting Elizabeth. That's why he made Zacharias mute. Here's Zacharias, and here's Elizabeth. And Zacharias says, honey, you're going to have a child. And here's Elizabeth. How about it, ladies? Huh? Huh? Those of you that are over 60, you want to have a child? Woo, doggies. After John's birth, when Zacharias confirmed that his name would be John, he was again able to speak. You know, a good lesson for us here is that when God answers your prayer, don't be surprised. I don't care if you've been praying for decades. Don't be surprised. But do tell other people. I think this is a good habit to get into and one that I fail at sometimes. Tell other people about it. Not bragging about yourself, not saying, whoa, boy, do I have power with God. I asked him for this and I got it. But just to boast about God that he hears and answers prayer. And you know, the bad thing about preaching is you're supposed to do what you say. So I want to share something that happened recently that I haven't told anyone about, and I feel chastened about that. Three or four months ago, with the So All May Hear email system, I got an email from Inland Empire Community Foundation. And they told me that they had received a $5 million grant, and they were to disperse that money to nonprofit organizations in San Bernardino and Riverside counties that had been impacted by the COVID pandemic. Well, I think that So All May Hear has been impacted, because my idea was to get in front of church groups and groups like children, Christian Women with a Message and so forth, and tell them about the opportunities, challenges, and needs of cross-cultural ministries and you know, raise money that way. Well, we couldn't meet together. I couldn't meet with people. So I thought, well, maybe we qualify. So I filled out the application. It was a pretty long application online, and honestly, I never thought I would get it. If I knew then what I know now, I would have applied for $10,000. But I didn't think that was really possible, and I gave some very short answers and not very detailed answers, and I emailed it back to him. Well, I'm here to tell you that on December 7th, here recently, $2,500 showed up in the So All May Hear bank account at U.S. Bank. When I opened the email here in my office and saw that, or I should say opened the U.S. Bank website and saw that, I got on my knees and thanked God, because I didn't think it was going to happen. I didn't see how this little bitty nonprofit, there's some huge nonprofits in Riverside and San Bernardino counties, but he granted to us $2,500. What a blessing. Thank you, God. When Zacharias could speak, he did speak. 23, when the days of his priestly service were ended, he went back home. Well, that's kind of a dull ending to an exciting 2 weeks. We're told nothing of his reunification with Elizabeth. We're told nothing of the questions she must have had for him. And that's probably because they don't matter to the redemptive narrative. Remember what John said about the ministry of Jesus. If everything he did had been written, the world would not have contained all the books which would have been written, which of course is hyperbole, exaggeration for effect. But the same is true here. God can only tell us so much. So Luke shares nothing until after these days, Elizabeth, his wife, became pregnant. That's verse 24, and that's where we're going to start next Sunday night. Indeed, Gabriel's words were fulfilled in their proper time. Our Father and our God, we are so grateful, Lord, that you have shared this story with us, these stories of what happened right before the birth of your Son. It's really important stuff. Scripture was fulfilled. All the wonderful things we learn about Zacharias and Elizabeth and the working that you did in their life. Humble people, Lord, but people who were obedient to you. We're grateful to learn of John the Baptist and his dedication to you and his control by you as he was filled with your Holy Spirit. Lord, we long for these things in our life, and we ask you that you would grant us, Lord, to be filled with your Spirit all the time, every day. And we know how we can tell if you bring that about, because there will be the fruit of the Spirit in our lives. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.